It's time to worship. How many's ready? Well, that sounded about half of you. I said, how many's ready to worship? There we go. We are looking forward to a great day in the Lord. You got a little elbow room today. We got some that are gone. Some are out. Some are traveling. We got some in vacation world. Some are in Springfield, Missouri. We got a lot out, but you got a little elbow room today. How many's liking your elbow room today? Don't get used to it. Well, let's stand this morning, and we're going to get ready. Our ushers are ready, and we're going to take what God has given us and bless back. Amen. This is the tithe and offering. That's all I'm going to say about it. We're going to take a special offering for the man of God in the house today, Evangelist Bruce Smithson. Would you give him a hand? And his helpmate today over here, Rose, would you give her a hand? Amen. Come on. We welcome them at Turning Point. We welcome you guys today. Lord, we welcome you most of all today. We welcome the Holy Spirit to come into this place, to move, to minister. God, do what you can only do. And Lord, we thank you today for every song. We thank you for the word that's about to come forth in this place. And we ask God that every person in here today, not only here, but also those that are online today, Father, that you will minister to their hearts. And Lord, this word today, I believe it is on time. And Father, we thank you for it. We give you praise for it today. And Lord, we have come to do one thing, and that is to lift you up and to give you glory for who you are. And we do that today in Jesus' name. Would you say amen? Amen. All right, let's worship.
Still to come. Oh.
on. Just lift your hands in this place. Come on, let's lift our hands and worship this morning. Come on, let's sing it through. Let's sing it. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. Yes, it is today, God. When they were singing that song earlier about glory and honor and power and how he fills the temple when we worship him. They ain't talking about this building. Talking about this temple. When you worship him, he see inhabits the praises. He inhabits. He wants, he desires our worship. The God of gods, the Lord of lords, the King of kings, desires my worship. He desires your worship. Doesn't that make you want to worship him just a little bit more? Amen.
Yeah.
Just a little bit more. I worship you, Jesus. We worship you, Jesus. We worship you in this place today, Lord. Above everything, high and lifted up. He's sitting on the right hand of the Father, making intercession for each and every one of us today. As I told you last Sunday, and I ended with last Sunday this story, and maybe some of you wasn't here to hear this, and I want to just share it real quick, because when I think about the temple, I think about King Uzziah, and I think about how the train filled the temple. And I told them last week, I said, I heard a minister say this, and I grew up in church all my life, never heard it preached. But when he began to teach this, he taught that every time, the reason this train was so long was that every time that the king won a victory, they put another train on. And they put another one on, and they put another one on. So every victory was represented, and it was so great that it filled the temple. How many in here today has got some victories that you can say, ah, my temple is full because of victories in my life, amen? Man, that changed me. That word just changed my life, amen? Thinking about the victories of God and how his presence fills our temple daily, amen? Every victory, God. We praise you today, Jesus. We love you, God. We thank you for everything you have done for us. And Father, we thank you for everything you're going to do. And we just honor you in this place today. In this time of worship, we offer those sacrifices of praise to you. We offer them to you, God. No one else I offer my praise to but you, God. I offer it to you today. And I thank you, and I worship you, and give you glory and honor in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Give him one praise that he deserves today. Come on, amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, amen. Give this team a hand. They did an awesome job, amen. Give them a hand today. Thank you, guys. You may be seated in the house for just a moment. We want to take this time and moment here to, man, I just sense his presence here. Do you sense it? Amen? So real in this place today. So good to see everyone here. Thank you for coming today. Thank you for coming and being a part of this service. And I want us today to do one thing. And I want you to look at who's this guy. But I want you to know this guy. God put us, connect us a long time ago, but as far as close, we're learning each other. But I know that He know where I came from, and I know where he came from. My pastor used to have him all the time to fill in over there. And then there's other ministers I know that are connected. And I saw Bruce at a conference, and he began to get a kind of wasn't sure about me. Because I told him, I said, Bruce, I'm going to get you over to preach. This man here was there for me when my dad passed. He was right there with me. He was right there for our family. And he's a good man. Amen. I'm going to give you the story in just a really quick point. But we met over at this conference I went to just recently. And he said, now, I know we're friends, but I'm starting to wonder. You keep telling me you're going to have me come preach. So I went home, got my calendar out, and I booked him. Come on, amen. And so he's here today, and I want you to make him feel welcome one more time, Eric. Give him a hand, amen. We're going to bring him up here in just a minute. We're going to receive an offering this morning to bless him and bless his family and his ministry. And this man has pastored. He knows what it is to stand where I stand. He's pastored churches. He evangelizes. He spent many years in different places, but God has used him all through the years. Amen. And you're here not by accident, but by purpose to hear this word. Amen. So open your hearts, open your ears, and receive today. We're going to give back right now. Ushers, if you're ready, we're going to give. Now, while we give, I want you to take a look up at the screen here. Last Sunday, we recognized 5 children. There was some of you that wasn't here, and I wanted you to see it. And we want live Facebook to see it. And so we want to put it out today one more time. These are 5 kids that learned 66 books of the Bible. And they, out of all of our kids, there was 5 that committed just to get it all out there. Amen. And one of them, I want to tell you the story. His family had visited that Sunday on Resurrection Sunday. They had visited that Sunday with us. And the son was in the service over there. And he told Doc, where'd Doc go? Doc, where's he at? Anyway, he's out there. But anyway, Doc was the teacher over that morning. And he told Doc, said, I know the books of the Bible. And his parents are here today. And I want to say thank you for doing what you do. Amen. Because, amen, that's big. A kid to walk in a room to nobody he knows and says, I know the books of the Bible. And he sings them. He don't just say them. And so in between, as we put this video together, just a 2-minute video, take a look at this and be blessed today by our children.
Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, and Ruth, 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, 1 Kings, and 2 Kings.
1 and 2 Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job.
Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentation.
Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, I think, Joel, Amos,
Obadiah, and Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, and Zephaniah,
Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi.
Okay, so you guys tell me if I'm right or wrong about these books of the Bible, okay? You ready? Genesis?
Yes.
Yes? Yes. Yes. Exodus?
Yes.
Leviticus?
Yes.
How about Proverbs? Is that a book?
Yes.
Okay, okay. How about the book of Captain America? Didn't he write a book?
No!
What? Captain? No? What?
Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts,
Romans, 1 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians,
Philippians, Colossians, 1 and 2 Thessalonians,
1 and 2 Timothy, Titus, and Philemon.
Hebrews, James, 1 and 2 Peter.
1, 2, and 3 John.
Jude, Revelations.
Jude and Revelation.
Jude and Revelation.
Jude and Revelations.
Now, Paul wrote in the New Testament the book of George. Have you guys ever read that letter, George?
No.
What? The book of George? Nobody's in it?
Awesome. And Kevin, raise your hand, wave your hand. And if you parents don't know, we have these five children. Are there you go, Kevin. Get with him. These five kids are taking, they've got a night planned for them. We promised them a prize, so they're going to be going bowling, and they're going to be doing putt-putt, and they're going to be eating. So they're going to have a blast that night. So thank you, parents, that took part in this and was able to, your children to be there and be a part. And so we're excited about it. Amen? Amen. That's just awesome when kids can do that. I'm glad they didn't challenge me. Amen. So, I taught D how to do it. 66 books in just a minute. Genesis dash Revelation. That's exactly how you do it right there. And everything in between counts as God's word. Amen. But I'm thankful for the goodness of God. Amen. Help me welcome Evangelist Bruce Smithson. Come on.
What a good-looking crowd. Amen. It's so good to be in the Lord's house today. Found out something this week. Women that are a little bit overweight live longer than their husbands that mentions it to them. That's a fact. I've been looking forward to this. To say that I'm impressed is understatement. I'm so impressed. Rose and I have been looking forward to this. Glad to have Rose, my wife, with me today. The Lord willing, this coming October, we will have been married 49 years. And I told her the other day, I said, if you get ready to go anywhere, let me know and I'll go with you. If you're packing suitcases, pack me one too. Amen. You know, here's the thing about marriage that I have learned over the years. A happy wife is a happy life. How many of you guys know that? Would you? Yeah. Guarantee. Yeah. You know, we sing that song, and when the battle's over, we'll wear a crown. No, we don't. We don't. So good to be with you today. I told somebody before service, I have been preaching 54 years. Now, what that means is absolutely nothing. Every day's a new day. Matter of fact, at the beginning of this year, I repented before the Lord, and I said, from now on, the rest of my life with you helping me, every time I stand in a pulpit, I'm going to preach as if it's the last time that I'll ever preach on this planet. And I'm going to do my best to commit myself to you. And I want you to know I appreciate Pastor Dwayne and Miss Jennifer very much. And I'm so glad to be here with him. Pastor, thank you for asking me. Most of the time when people hear me, I don't get many invitations, really. And I hardly ever get asked back twice. So I'm being foolish this morning. But I'm so glad to be here. How many will listen fast if I'll preach fast? I've always wanted to preach all day, and I'm thinking that maybe this is it. Yeah, you say bring it, and probably about 2 hours, we'll all grow weary and well-doing, wouldn't we? Did you know, have you ever heard of the message, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God? That was preached by Jonathan Edwards in the 1700s. That message lasted 7 hours. Men and women held the back of the seats and their fingernails turned purple, some of them screaming, "Please, preacher, stop and let me repent of my sins." That is conviction, folks. And we need conviction in the church of Jesus like we've never had it before. We've got a world that is so messed up, it just gives me a pain I can't locate. I just celebrated my 50-year class reunion. Somebody asked me, "What did you learn, or what have you learned in all these years?" I said, "When I was 5 years old, in the first grade, it said boys and girls. I knew I belonged there, and I did not belong there." And I also know that I didn't have to wait till I was 3 years old for me to decide what gender I wanted to be. We've got a messed up world, folks. It's time that the Church of Jesus Christ arises out of the ashes and proclaims the good news of the gospel, that Jesus is alive and well. He's on the throne. He's King of Kings, Lord of Lords, and Master of this universe. Amen. Well, turn with me, please, to Matthew chapter number 6. Matthew chapter number 6. For all of us Bible scholars, that's in the New Testament. And it's page 622 in my Bible. Everybody there, say amen. Amen. Matthew 6, verse 5. "And when thou prayest," it doesn't give any indication there that we shouldn't pray, but when we pray, "thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest," say that with me, "when thou prayest," then it says, "enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut the door, pray to the Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly." Here's the title of the message this morning, verse number 7. "But when you pray, use not vain repetition as the heathen do, for they think they shall be heard of their much speaking. Be not ye therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things you have need of," hallelujah, "before you ask him." And then he gives us the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Say it with me. "Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." And say a rousing amen with me this morning. When you pray, let me say this before we get started. Nothing's going to happen. What's the name of this church? I don't even know where I'm at. It's Gentry. How much? Turning Point Fellowship. Nothing is going to happen at Turning Point Fellowship. Nothing is going to happen in this city. Nothing's going to happen in your family, my family, until we learn the secret of prayer. Amen. It says, "Our Father," first of all. This prayer of Jesus puts us in positions that we need to be in order for us to be what we ought to be in our life, in our Christian walk, in our family. Oh, listen, the family needs a touch of God like it has never needed before. Families are divorcing and falling apart. Kids are messed up and on drugs. Aren't you glad your kids are saved, born again, and ready for heaven, and your grandkids? The Bible said, teach it to your kids, your children's children. And so, how many grandpas and grandmas we got in here? Oh, there's several of us. We're still around. And we've got a responsibility to our grandkids to teach them the things of the Lord. I thought about it several times. What would be the epithet that I would want for my grandkids to say about me when I leave this world? And it would be simply this: Paw-Paw lived for Jesus. Paw-Paw was a praying man. It's not so much that they say Paw-Paw's a good preacher, a fair preacher, or he's a bad. None of that matters. The fact that Paw-Paw lived for God and knew how to pray would be the greatest epithet that we could have written about us when we leave this planet. Can you say amen? Our Father, which art in heaven, our Father puts us in the position that we are children of God. My mother and dad are gone, but I used to walk in my mama's kitchen. When I would walk in there, I didn't ask. I didn't say, can I? I would just walk and open that refrigerator and get out of there what I wanted. Hallelujah. The table of God is spread. Amen. And we are children of God. He's our Father. We're His children. We're joint heirs with Christ. He is our propitiation. We are in the position of being children of God. I said, stop right there. There be shouting, and you're still sitting there. We're children of God. We're His. We're the sheep of His pasture. The golden text of the Bible: the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. And he, at the end of that, he says, got two angels following me. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. And when I leave this world, I'll dwell in the presence of God forever. Hallelujah. I'm a child of the King this morning. Then he says, hallowed be thy name. You know what that means? We are worshipers. I love this praise team. I've been in thousands of churches in my lifetime, in my 54 years, and I have found something to be a fact. If you're going to have trouble in the church, it'll be in the music. But I felt like there was unity on this platform this morning. You're up here for the right purpose. Amen. That's the worship, the King of Kings. We are to worship Him. It's not about me. It's not about you. But it's about the Lord God Almighty that made heaven and earth. And we are worship. Hallowed be thy name. John chapter 4 says, they that worship God must worship Him in spirit and in truth, because God is a spirit. And because of that, we are, and that means that Bruce's flesh is unimportant in the house of God. That's good preaching, Bruce. Thank you. I'm enjoying it too. I said, my flesh, everything that I've got to offer is unimportant in the house of God. It's all about worshiping Him. And you remember the scripture that said, if two or three, can I get down there? If two or three are gathered in my name, I'll be in the midst of them. What does that mean? Does that mean two people? We use that on Sunday night or a Wednesday night. Well, God said, if two people are here on Wednesday night, he'll be here. That's not what that scripture means. You can have two people in the house of God and they're not together in worship. God's a million miles from that. But you get two people, 5,000 people in the house of God worshiping God. He says, I like that so much, I'll be in the midst of it. You know what he does? He falls right out of the glory of heaven, and he falls with the anointing of the Holy Ghost upon a church that hallows his name. Amen. And worships his name. Would you just do that for a minute? Just raise your hands and worship him. Hallelujah. Number three, he says, thy kingdom come. That simply means that we are to be kingdom seekers. I said, it's not about us. It's about his kingdom. I am so, can I say this? Brother Dwayne, straighten me out, Pastor. I'm at your discretion, but I've got to say it anyway, and you can get on to me after church. I'm nauseated at a church world that I see now, that it's all about what we can do and what kind of show we can put on. It's not about a show and our talent, but it's about being in the position of seeking the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these other things will be added unto us. The Bible said in Luke, fear not, little flock, for it is the Father's good pleasure. It is the Father's good pleasure. Say it again, preacher. It is the Father's good pleasure to give to you the kingdom. To give to you the kingdom. What is the kingdom? I'm glad that you asked. Jesus said, greater things shall you do because I'm going to the Father. In Acts chapter 1, Jesus was there, all of a sudden ascended from this earth. Two angels appeared in the heavens and they said something that is very relevant this morning. This same Jesus that you've seen taken away will come in like manner as you've seen him taken away, but go and tarry in Jerusalem. That's kingdom seekers. 120 folks gathered in the upper room in Jerusalem. Rose and I were there 2 years ago in April, and we were in that upper room. We began to sing, oh Lord, send the power just now. Oh, some of you folk, you know that song, oh Lord, send the power just now and baptize everyone. And it felt like in that other upper room in Jerusalem, there was a breath of heaven and the Holy Ghost that centered itself upon us. And I could not hardly stand it. If I wasn't so dignified, I just shouted all over that place. Kingdom seekers. Hebrews said, wherefore we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Everybody look at me. Look at me right in the whites of the eyes. If there ever was a time that God's people that are called by God's name had a baptismal service of a new experience of godly fear, we're surely in that hour. I'm not talking about being afraid of God. I'm talking about kingdom seekers that know that God is God and God will do anything for you that you can ask. He's God on the platform. He's God in the pew. He's God at the back door. He's God all over this house as we seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. This world is all about stuff. I was in the funeral business. I never did have a U-Haul behind the hearse going to the cemetery. Job said, naked I came into this world and I'll leave this world the same way. But this world has a lot of stuff. It's all about stuff. But there is a scripture that says, is anybody getting anything out of this? Some of you kind of look at me like a bullfrog in a hailstorm, and like I've got two heads, but I'm trying to help you. I'm trying. Is that all right? It said, "Seek you first the kingdom of God and His righteousness." Seek you first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all of these other things will be added unto you. Television preachers say, name it, claim it, blab it, and grab it. And I'm all about prosperity. I believe in it. But I also remember He said, I would that you prosper and be in good health even as your soul prospers. I am to be a kingdom seeker. Hallelujah. Boy, you people preach a guy to death. It says, thy will be done. That puts us in the position to live as servants and completely obedient to God. Hey, how many of you believe that we ought to be obedient to God? How many of you believe we ought to be holy? How many of you believe that we oughtn't to be watching stuff on TV and then shouting on Sunday morning? Is that all right, preacher? Amen. We're supposed to live it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. I've been on platforms for a long time, and it's amazing to me on Sunday morning. You can tell they're not having church in the house when she gives him the elbow, and he has got a burnt offering that morning before he come to church. You'll get it. Kingdom seekers, servants, and obedient to God. If a man serve me, the Bible says, let him follow me. And where I am, everybody say, where I am, that's Jesus. Where I am, there also will my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. You know who you really are and who I really am. I am who I am in God when nobody else is looking. I am who I am in God when the light is turned off. That's good preaching, Bruce. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Pastor. Because when nobody else is looking, that's who I really am. Hey, this woman of 49 years come October knows me real well. I don't want her testifying this morning about me. Because if you thought that you had a perfect preacher, guess again. I'm just human like you are, trying to position myself as a servant and obedient to the Lord. Now listen to this. Romans says it like this. Know you not that to whom you yield yourself servants to obey, his servants you are whom you obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Have you ever, don't raise your hand, don't even say, man, it's not a good time. But have you ever said something to somebody and wished to God you could take it back? Well, I have done it to that woman sitting right there. And I'm a pretty good husband, I think. She tells me I am. And if I'm not, then we'll have a prayer meeting for her lying spirit here in just a minute. But can I ride home with somebody else? To whom we yield ourselves to, that's who we are in obedience to. And that tongue is the biggest influence of unrighteousness there is on this earth. Because I'm telling you, when somebody cuts me off in the road, hey, look at me. I'm not big enough to do anything. I don't usually do anything but look ahead and say, God, help me not to sin. But I feel that unrighteousness rise up, and I'm amazed sometimes at, and they're not always young kids. They call it road rage. It's not always kid. Sometimes it's white-headed old guys like me that just act like an idiot. Listen, I'm saying their obedience is not of God, but it is to that tongue, and what comes out is be a good place to say amen there. Amen. Then it says, give us this day our daily bread. That means that we are to be positioned in prayer to be dependent not on ourselves but on God Almighty. In Romans, or Matthew said it like this, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and it shall be open unto you. He that asketh receiveth, he that seeketh findeth, and he that knocketh it is open unto. How many of you know that God can do anything? I was preaching in Russellville a month or so back, January, last Sunday of January. This man brought his wife at the end of the service, and I'm not a healing preacher. I don't even know what I am, but I can assure you of this. I have no power in myself. He brought his wife and said, for the last 5 years, and he told me the disease, and I can't remember, but he said, I want you to pray for her tonight. You remember when the little woman with the issue of blood touched the hem of the Lord's garment, and he said, Jesus, daughter, thy faith has made you whole for some reason. I've never done it before. I don't know if I'll ever do it again. I just laid my hand ever so gently on that lady, and I said, daughter, thy faith has made you whole. And I said it again, daughter, thy faith has made you whole. And I said it again, daughter, thy faith has made. The pastor called me on Wednesday. She went to the doctor, and the doctor said, there is not whatsoever anything that looks like that disease. I'm talking about ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. And it's not wrapped up in a preacher. It's not wrapped up in flesh. It's wrapped up in faith in a God that can do anything. Hallelujah. Be dependent on God. Whatsoever you ask in my name, Jesus said, I will do it, that the Father may be glorified, that the Father may be glorified in the Son, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. It's not flesh. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Hallelujah. To be dependent. Then he says, deliver us from evil. Oh, everybody look at me. That puts us in a position to abstain from evil. Amen. When the light's off, you're not looking at... Hey, when I started preaching, we preached against television. Some of you, that's foreign to you. You don't. Yeah, we preach against everything, and even the chocolate in a Hershey candy bar. We preached Jesus was coming and nobody was going. And most of us acted like we was kind of proud they weren't. Surely to God, there's somebody in this house been back in those days. And back when we preached against television, the worst thing that was on there is old Barney Fife and Gomer. Ernest T. Bass. It's me, it's me, it's Ernest T. You ain't heard the last of Ernest T. Bass. I'm not talking. The more you're asking, the more I'm balking. That's the worst thing on there. Now then, anything you watch on that thing is a cesspool out of hell, and the devil is using it on our church folks. You better say amen, or I think you're guilty. amen, a position to abstain. Deliver us from evil. 2 Timothy, he said, who hath saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. How long have I been preaching? I don't want to preach. Sometimes I'll get an hour in there, but I'm trying not to. Rose gets on to me for that. But have I got time? Thank you. And thank you, brother. Thank you. I thought about something this week, and it was about Job. Here's the position of Job. The Bible said that Job served God. That's a reason God bragged on him. And it said while he was in his place of torment, he still served God, right? And then it said he lived after his torment for four generations. He saw his kids again before he died. That meant before Job served God, beneath all of that he served God, and beyond all of it he served God. That meant he believed that he was Lord of Lords before, he believed that he was Lord of Lords beneath, and he believed that he was Lord of Lords after. He believed that he was the son of righteousness before. He was the son of righteousness beneath, and he was the son of righteousness beyond. He also believed that he was King of Kings before. He was King of Kings beneath, and he's Alpha and Omega beyond. Hallelujah. Oh, he believed that he was a lily of the valley before, and he's a lily of the valley beneath, and he shall be the lily of the valley beyond all of your trouble. I come to tell you this morning, if you'll position yourself around him, he'll be your Lord, your master, your savior forever and ever. I'm telling you, me and this girl right here have seen God move miraculously years ago. I don't know why I'm telling this. It's not in the notes. Preaching a revival in Stuttgart, Arkansas. Little lady came up all bent over with arthritis or some kind of spinal. We began to pray, and there was testimony given that bones were heard cracking as she walked out of that building completely made whole. I'm talking about a God before, a God beneath, and a God beyond your situation this morning. If I were to mention John Newton to you this morning, some of you would have no idea who John Newton is. If I were to mention this morning an old song that most of us know, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost. Oh, I'm about to have a fit, and now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Yonder in England, John Newton's little mama worked in washing clothes on a rub board. Some of you kids have no idea what a rub board is. Some of you ladies may be old enough, you participated on that. And John Newton's little mama had no idea where John Newton was, but she knew the avenue of prayer. And she said, God, somewhere on the high seas. You see, John Newton was a slave trader, bringing slaves to this country under the influence of demonic powers from hell. Mama said, God, I don't know where my son, my boy is. As she rubbed and washed those clothes, and tears streamed down her face and mingled her tears in the suds of that wash water, God, would you save my boy? God, would you have mercy on John out there on the high seas? John Newton came to Jesus Christ, not necessarily because that God called his name, and yet he did through the soap suds of that little mama over there that said, God, would you listen to this preacher. Doesn't matter where your kids are this morning. Doesn't matter how messed up your grandkids are. We're serving a God that if we'll position ourselves and pray until God hears from heaven, nothing is impossible with him. This Jesus, we celebrated Resurrection Sunday, 2 weeks ago? Something like that. You were here, you had a big crowd. You didn't have the elbow room you got this morning, did you? Isn't that wonderful? That's a good problem. I like problems like that in the church. But this Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. The Bible said he prayed. He set the prerequisite for our praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. Father, if it be thy will, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, that's where we got to get to, Pastor. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. They tell us that his sweat became as great drops of blood. A Baptist preacher got a hold of that and went to a medical doctor. And he said, doctor, what would cause a man's sweat to become as a great drop of blood? He said his heart could actually rupture inside of his chest. And there is a sac. And I remember studying that in mortuary college. There's a sac around the heart. And for a period of time, you can live. You can actually live for a while. If that's the case, Pastor Dwayne, Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane with his heart ruptured inside of his chest. I see him yonder in the Garden of Gethsemane, and the Roman soldiers are coming to get him and bring him out of the garden, placing the crown of thorns on his head that I can have a crown of righteousness, slapping him across his face where I know how it feels when somebody slap. Oh, Hebrews said, we have not a high priest that cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. With his heart ruptured inside of his chest, they took him before Pilate. Pilate washed his hands. A lot of folks are washing their hands in 2021 and saying, I don't know the man. I don't see any fault, but I don't need to participate in a bloody mess like Calvary was. I don't want to participate in that, but I heard the songwriter say, nothing but the blood. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And I heard the songwriter say, there is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's vein, and sinners still plunge beneath that flood and lose all their guilty stains. They beat him 39 times across his back. He put us in a position of prayer. There are 39 diseases that they know of. Isn't that amazing? 39 diseases derived in the human body, and he took 39 stripes across his back. Isn't that amazing? God articulates everything perfectly. My Lord, I said, they'll be shouting and you're sitting there. I don't understand. So they took him out of Pilate's judgment hall after beating him unmercifully, the crown of thorns on his head, took him up to the place called Calvary, and there they nailed him to the cross. For your information, just for your information, they didn't just drive the nails through his hands. That would not hold a human body on the cross. They drove it back through his wrist bones and back through his heel bone. And with a sickening thud, they dropped that cross into the hole on Golgotha's hill, the place of the skull. And there, when they dropped that cross, he positioned us for prayer. The 17th chapter of St. John, he said, now they're in the world. He's talking about you. He's talking about you. He's talking about you, and he's talking about me. They're in the world, but Father, I'm praying you'll keep them from the world. Amen. Somebody said, I can't live above sin. My God, you can live above sin, because Jesus went to the cross with a sickening thug on Calvary, ripping every ligament in his body. He hung there with his heart ruptured inside of his chest. Isaiah said, not one bone in his body will be broken. Just for your information, I'm trying to wrap this up. This is not in the notes. This is just Bruce chapter 1. For your information, crucifixion was a most gruesome way to die. When they got through taunting, the man or woman that was being crucified, mostly men, they would take a stick, run it in behind his legs, snap the bones in his legs, his body would sag, and he would suffocate in a matter of seconds. Isaiah said not one bone in his body would be broken. Do you remember when Jesus said, it is finished? It is finished in the Greek means tetelestai. You want to know what tetelestai means? When you get out of prison and you've served your debt to society, they put on that paper from the prison system, I suppose, in that day, tetelestai, the debt has been paid. And when Jesus, I'm about to have a fit. When Jesus said it is finished, I'm telling you, the debt of sin was paid and is paid and is still paid in 2020. Can somebody praise him and thank him this morning? And a Roman soldier said, I'll do one more thing. I'm going to run out there, and I'm going to pierce his side. And the Bible said when a soldier pierced his side, blood and water flowed from the chest cavity of Jesus. I already know what I'm going to say, and I'm about to have a fit. He opened up Emmanuel's vein that's been flowing for 2,000 years, and sinners still plunge beneath the flood of Calvary. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Well, I'm going to close. I can do that several times. The Apostle Paul about three times said, finally, brethren. And he went three more chapters. But I really am going to close right now. I can tell you about this Jesus. He's called the King of Kings and the King of Jews. He was called the Son of God. He is the Savior born in Bethlehem, Christ the Lord. He is the Word that became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory as the Son of Almighty God. He is the Christ, the risen. I said, He is the risen Lord, proclaiming salvation to the nations, and whosoever shall call upon His name shall be saved. He is the Spirit at work in the churches. I said, He is the Spirit that's at work in the churches. Listen, I'm working a lot harder than you are, so just stay with me a minute. In Ephesians, he said to put on the whole armor of God. He is our righteous armor. He is the God who shall supply all of our needs according to His riches and glory. He's the mediator between God and man. I'm closing, and you get ready to help me. That's the only way I'll shut up. And you have you ever had the enemy after you? Listen, he's got after you and you don't know which way to turn. You talk to your wife and she felt compassion, but she couldn't help you. You went to your neighbor and they had compassion, but they couldn't help you. And you just got to the place, I don't know what I'm going to do. But it said in the text, but when you pray, enter into your closet. Get there before God. I've been there. I've been there. I've been there as a pastor. I've been there as an evangelist. I didn't know what to do, but I got before him and I said, for thou art the altogether lovely one, the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Thou art the one that bled and died on that cross that I might have life and have it more abundantly. Now, I don't know, Lord, how that I'm going to come through this situation. I don't know how you're going to fix it. But you said, if I'll believe in my heart and confess with my mouth, you'll do exactly what I say. I believe that you're the one that came to this earth. You bled, you died, and rose again and said, greater things shall you do because I go to the Father. I looked around and the enemy of my soul that was breathing hot breath from hell down my shirt collar, he's not there anymore. He's gone because he cannot stand the presence of a holy, holy God. Hey, I thought I'd tell you this morning, he is Lord of lords and King of kings. Oh, I wish I could preach all day. I could do it today, but I won't. Bow your heads. The greatest injustice that could be done in this service is not to give you an opportunity to come to Jesus. I don't understand how a man or a woman can live their life without knowing Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Hey, look at me just for a minute, if you will, before I know I ask you to bow your head, but we celebrated Easter Sunday or Resurrection Sunday. He went into the caverns of the damned, and he pulled the keys of death, hell, and the grave away from Satan. Can you imagine the rumble in hell when this man that Satan thought was never going to bother him again? And I've read Revelation, and he's not the same Jesus this second time. John the Revelator said, I saw his eyes, they're like fire. I saw his vesture with blood dripping from his, and his feet like undefined brass. He stepped out on Resurrection Sunday for your sins, turned around at that grave and said, oh, grave, where is thy victory? Oh, death, where is thy sting? He was saying the strength of sin and death and your sin and my sin was left in that empty tomb and nailed to that cross. 2011, I said bye to my mother and dad. Both of them died 6 months apart. I was sitting where Brother Pastor Dwayne is. I never shed a tear at my mother and dad's funeral. The only reason is because I knew what they had lived. And I remember watching that casket lid, and I've closed to many of them. I watched it. As long as I could see, the last thing I saw was my daddy's nose. And I sat there and I said, there's a great getting up morning. Paul said, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound. Out yonder in that graveyard, there's going to be a convulsion that's going to shake that graveyard, and the dead have got prerequisite over us, and they're coming out of that grave first. And we which are alive and remain shall be called up together to meet the Lord in the air. And I thought, why did he say in the air? Good Lord, you people are preaching me to death. Why did he say in the air? Heard my buddy Dean Caldwell answer that. He said, because the princes and the powers and the rulers of darkness are in the air. And we're going to meet him in the air, and it's going to be show-off time. And Jesus is going to say, this is the church in Gentry that lived for God, that was faithful to the cross, that lived in righteousness, and devil, you didn't get them. They're now robed in white robes of righteousness. I kind of hope they have fried potatoes and brown beans and cornbread at the married supper of the Lamb. Anybody that's anybody likes that. You know, when I was a kid, we had brown beans and cornbread, brown beans and fried potatoes. Then we switched it around and we had fried potatoes and brown beans. I don't know what we're going to eat at the marriage supper of the Lamb, but if I was here this morning, I was lost. You couldn't make me not come to this altar and get right with God. I don't understand it. A person that would live away from God, die without God. If you're here this morning, you're not a Christian, would you come? Would you just come? Just be courageous enough to say, I want to go to heaven and not hell. Hey, there is a heaven. There is a hell. Now, preachers don't preach on it anymore much, but there's a hell. The Bible said the worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. God, give us a vision of hell again in the church. I wait just a moment on you're not saved. Would you come? If you're here in this service this morning and you say, I want to learn the avenue of prayer like I've never known it before, I want to know what it is. I was preaching a camp meeting in southern Missouri 2 years ago. And we had prayer meeting every day at 10 o'clock. We went all week. We prayed. But on Saturday morning, you listen to me, Saturday morning there was a breath of the glory of God that filled that little church house. And I'm telling you, we stayed there in the presence of, there is a place, God told Moses by me, church, I want to tell you there's a place in prayer. And if you want to know what that is, I want you to come and stand across this building. We're going to close this service. I'm turning it back to your pastor. But if you want to know about prayer and you want to have the avenue of prayer in your life, just come and stand just for a moment. We're going to turn this place into a prayer meeting. I want to know what prayer is like I've never known before. You're coming. You're coming. I'm in no hurry. You're coming. You're coming. There is a place by me. Pastor, you know what I would like? I would like to be like Moses when he came off of that mountain. They had to put a veil over his face because the glory of God was shining. Every one of these that's come for prayer this morning, if the rest of you will help me, everybody that'll help me pray for these, would you come get behind them? Let's ask God to turn their face into the glory of God. You're coming all over the building. Amen. I know I preached long, but I'm done. Let's let God do the rest. Find you somebody and let's pray. Hallelujah. Father, every one of these this morning, I pray, God, that you will do what only you can do. Let there be a consequence of prayer that will radiate from this life, from this family. God, I pray that you'll let an avenue of prayer begin, that they'll know what it is to touch the hem of his garment. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, do what only you can do. Our faith has made us whole. Our faith has made us whole. And in you we live, we move, and we have our being. God, teach us to pray like we never prayed. In the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Praise God. Praise God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. in the name that is above every name. Hallelujah. God, touch these around this altar. Let an avenue of prayer and the position of prayer be in every one of them, God, I pray. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that's within me, I bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, who forgiveth all of my iniquities, who healeth all of my diseases, and crowneth me with loving kindness and tender mercies. I believe that's what he's doing around this altar this morning. God, touch this congregation. Let the power of the Holy Ghost, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God, we worship you. We worship you. We worship you. We worship you. You are Lord of Lords. Worship him, worship him, worship him. Let God have his way. Let God arise and his enemies be scattered. Let God arise and his enemies be scattered. Hallelujah. Here I am to worship you. Here I am to worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. You're my God, you're my God, you're my God. Hallelujah.
Come on, let's just stand and come on, let's just give him worship in his house. Is he your God? Is he your God? You know, he said he couldn't get stopped there. I know about that. But I tell you this thing right here. What he did this morning, you know my heart. The Lord told me weeks and weeks ago, I stepped in this pulpit many years, preached a message, but he told me never leave a service. And you gave the opportunity this morning for him to know Jesus. I do it every Sunday, whether I have zero or we have one. I want to tell you something. Not only salvation, but God can rededicate your life. Amen. He can. Amen. And he has. Many will. Many. We've seen God do in this place. And I thank you for being that minister, not afraid to give that invitation. Amen. And if you didn't receive that invitation, that's not on him. That's not on me. It's on you. Well, I'd had to walk in front of everybody. He walked in front of everybody for you. Amen. So I know we already had it. And I'm getting that wife look too. And I'm going to look this way. No, I'm just kidding. She ain't giving me a look. But I want you to do this right thing with me. If this morning, before we walk out of this room, if you did not, you heard his invitation, you heard God do it, and you, I don't want you to walk out of here without it. So, praise team, we're going to flip you to old school just for a minute. We're going back to that song, Amazing Grace. I know you like that. I know you love that. And well, we're going to sing, but here's the thing. When we sing, if you're here and you didn't step out and you need the Lord in your life, or you need to be rededicated to him, it's for what we're singing about. It's about the amazing grace. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to step out. Well, I've been here a few times. So what? You're family. When you came through that door, you are family. And we mean that. Amen. You're family. So right now, we're going to sing it. You guys are going to take it back. Take us back a little moment there. But if you're here today and you need to be saved, or you need to rededicate your life to Jesus, it ain't nothing to have to be long. You walk up here, we pray with you, and let me tell you, God can do some great things in just minutes. Amen. Come on in this house, and we will praise God with you while you walk that aisle. Come on, let's sing it this morning. Here we go. If you're here, come. Come. You want me to start it? No, I'm just kidding. Come on.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Come on. Without knowing Jesus.
Together, come on. If you're here, he's waiting.
Amazing.
once was lost. Are you found? Raise your hands. Now. Well, in the old school, we'd do something like this. Well, praise God. Somebody give him a praise. Come on, give him a shout this morning. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you don't feel Jesus in this place, I want to tell you this morning, he loves you. He cares about you. You say, well, what about my past? He don't care. We all in here had a past. We all have one. But Jesus has forgot about it. And he forget yours too. Amen. Just give him all of your life and say, God, I serve you. I'll serve you with everything within me. Man, I know it's here. Amen. And I thank God for his presence. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, Father, we have done everything that we can do, Lord, on this side. We pray the Holy Spirit continue to work in every heart and every life. As we leave this place today, Father, we do it in honor of a great, great God. We thank you today for not ever giving up on us, God. I just feel that in this place. Thank you for never giving up on me, God. Can you say that in this room with me today? Say, thank you, God, for never giving up on me. Thank you, Jesus. And Lord, today I commit myself to serve you and do your will and follow you every step. As you said, the steps of a righteous person are ordered by you, God. And I accept the order. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Come on, give him one more big praise, amen. I'm going to let the evangelist and his wife, if you want to slip out, they can get you, so we can shake your hand. We'll get you to the back before everybody else starts moving because you won't get through. And this morning, ushers, I didn't tell you this, but if you want to have a basket and you say, you know what, I didn't give in the offering because I didn't know that man, but the Lord has spoke to you and you want to do something extra, we'll give you that opportunity today as you leave. Amen. He didn't ask for a dime. I'm just wanting you, if you want to bless the man of God, it'll be available. Amen. God bless you today. Shake hands and give Jesus one more shout of praise. Come on. Amen. Amen.